We're going to take the work we've done using thermochemical equations and enthalpies of formation to solve this problem. And you're not given the thermochemical equations. You have to write your own. And the clue is use enthalpies of formation. There is a way to solve this problem mathematically without having to write out the full thermochemical equations. I don't teach it that way. For General Chemistry 1, I believe students need to write out the full-on enthalpies of formation equations and then manipulate them in order to get the final answer. Because if you don't see the manipulations of the chemical equations, you lose track as to why you're doing it the way you are. So let's take a look at the given equation, the desired equation, and see what we need. Well, we need to write an equation for methane. Now, at the moment, I don't care how many methanes there are, 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5. I don't even care in the desired equation, the top one, whether it's a reactant or a product. When you write the equations out, you write out enthalpies of formation equations. And an enthalpy of formation equation shows the formation of methane from its elements. Carbon and hydrogen gases. Watch your diatomics. Watch your state labels. If you need to, go back and review the podcast on writing enthalpies of formation equations. And then I pull this value out of the appropriate table. Next, I look at gaseous water. And again, I don't care that it's a reactant. I'll fix that later. And I don't care that there's two. I'll fix that later. So that shows hydrogen gas and oxygen gas making water vapor. And then you pull the appropriate value out of the table. Now this is why I'm not worried yet that there's two water vapors in the desired equation, because enthalpies of formation are per mole. We have carbon dioxide in the desired equation. So I'll write 1 for carbon dioxide. So the elements in carbon dioxide are carbon and oxygen. Again, watch your state labels. And the appropriate table value is there. Now we have one more thing to worry about, and that's the hydrogen gas. Actually, we don't have to worry about that. When you're solving these problems, anything in the desired equation that's an element, you ignore. So the H2 gas, we ignore. If in that equation there had been solid sodium, we would have ignored that. If there would have been N2 gas, we would have ignored that. Because it's in there. If you look in the equations we just wrote, H2 gas is in there. And if we manipulate these equations properly, when we're done, and we add up the manipulated equations, we'll have 4H2 gas. So one at a time. Here's the equation we wrote for methane. Now, this is when I worry about having it as either a reactant or a product, and I worry about how many of them I need. Now, in the desired equation, we need methane as a reactant. So I'll reverse that equation. It's for 1 methane, and the bottom equation is for 1 methane, so I'm good. As to the enthalpy of reaction for this one, look up on the right. The formation value is -74.9. We reverse the reaction, so it becomes +74.9. And the multiplication part, it seems like it's not needed, but it is needed. Standard enthalpies of formation are kilojoules per mole. How many moles are you taking? If you look up at the desired equation, it's for 1 mole. So I have to multiply this by 1 mole. And I know you can do multiplication by 1, I get it. But enthalpies of formation are kilojoules per mole. The enthalpies of reaction, without the F, they're kilojoules. It's for the reaction the way it's written. Push this aside. Now let's work on the water vapor. So there's the equation we wrote for that. In the desired equation, the H2O gas is a reactant. So I have to reverse my reaction. And in the desired equation, it's for 2 moles of H2O gas. So I had to multiply all those coefficients by 2. I reversed the reaction, so I changed the sign on the enthalpy. Positive 241.8 kilojoules per mole. And in the desired equation, I want 2 moles of water vapor, so I multiply it by 2. That's the manipulation I did to the chemical equation anyway. Push that aside. Carbon dioxide. Now, the bottom equation is already written in the correct direction. No need to reverse it. Good. And in the desired equation, it's 1 CO2, which is good because I don't have to do anything to the chemical part. I do have to manipulate properly the standard enthalpy of formation. So I take that and I multiply it by 1 mole because that's how many moles of carbon dioxide I want. So let's see where we stand. These are the 3 manipulated equations. And we have to make sure we did it right. So we're going to add up the chemical equations first. Now remember, when you add them up, you are able to remove common items on the left and right side of the arrows when you add them all up, as if they were mathematical equations. So that's why I'm removing the carbon solid, and that's why I'm removing the O2 gas from each side. What's left over? I have methane, 2 water vapors, 4 hydrogen gas, and 1 carbon dioxide gas. Let's compare the bottom equation, the one I just got from adding them up, to the desired equation, and they match. Now, I realize in the products, the carbon dioxide and the hydrogen gases are switched, but that doesn't matter. I've got same reactants, same products. We're good. Which means, since I added the chemical equations up, and they added up properly, I can now add up the enthalpies of reaction. And that +165.0 kilojoules is the standard enthalpy of reaction for the steam conversion of methane into carbon dioxide and hydrogen gases. And maybe that looks familiar. Well, it should look familiar. We did this problem a different way. We added together the steam methane reformer reaction along with the water gas shift reaction, and we got the same overall chemical equation, and we got the same standard enthalpy of formation. That illustrates the idea of path independence. Take 2 different chemical paths to get to the same answer. Well, the enthalpy change should be approximately the same.